are we talking about? Back to that throne that we saw, and those 24 elders with their thrones. I saw underneath the altar the souls of those who had been slaughtered because of the word of God and because of the testimony which they had maintained out of loyalty to Christ. They cried in a loud voice, saying, O Lord, holy and true, how long now before you will sit in the judgment and avenge our blood on those who, the unregenerate ones, the sinners, who dwell on the earth? It's important here to notice that they're asking, Lord, how long before you will avenge our deaths, our loyalty to you where we died for you, based on those who are sinners? Because remember, the martyrs could include maybe some of us now, some who have certainly died in past years, in past history. There will be some in the future before the Lord comes, who are sitting before the Lord asking, how long will it be before this judgment, before you will avenge our blood? And notice that they say here, the blood on those regenerate ones who dwell on the earth. So if the martyrs are saying this to Jesus in this heavenly scene that we're seeing, and they're referring to the people on earth, is this something that is happening simultaneously? Or is this afterwards? Because there are people still dwelling on earth, it would sound like, from the reading, with the martyrs who are calling to the Lord. We'll talk about this timing later. Then they were each given a white robe, and they were told to rest and wait quietly for a little while longer until the number of their fellow servants and their brothers and sisters who were to be killed, even as they had been, would be completed. So see here again, we have this idea that there are going to be more martyrs, right? There are going to be more fellow servants, their brothers and sisters who were to be killed. That's future. Future even to the time when these martyrs are calling out before the Lord to be completed. Be patient, wait a little while longer until the number is completed. The sixth seal, terror. I looked when he, the Lamb, broke open the sixth seal, and there was a great earthquake, and the sun became black as sackcloth made of hair, and the whole moon became like blood. And the stars of the sky fell to the earth like a fig tree shedding its late summer figs when shaken by a strong wind. The sky was split, separated from the land, not split us from whom, hide us from he who sits on the throne and from the righteous wrath and indignation of the Lamb. Hide us from what? Hide us from the wrath. Hide us from the judgment, is what they're asking. For the great day of their wrath and vengeance and retribution has come. And he who is able to face God and stand before the wrath of the Lamb. Who is he? Who can stand before the sight of God? You remember how I was saying a few moments ago, it's only possible for us to stand before the sight of God by the blood of the Lamb of Jesus. If we can accept his sacrifice, then we can have the destiny of being able to stand in our glorified bodies in the midst of the Lord, in the midst of the Lord. Because if you don't have that, if you don't have that sanction, if you don't have that glorified body, if you don't have that relationship of standing and overcoming, if you don't have that relationship of conquering sin through the blood of Jesus, who then can stand before the wrath of God? Who do you think that you could stand when the mountains are falling, when the sky is being rended and rent apart from the earth? Do you think you could stand in that great earthquake, that wrath? No one can stand. Not even the mighty military folks can stand. Not even the wealthy, not the rich, not the powerful, not the slave or the free can stand without the power and glory of our Lord and Savior Jesus the Christ. And after this, in Revelation 7, after this I saw four angels stationed at the four corners of the earth, holding back the four winds of the earth so that no wind would blow on the earth or on the sea or on any tree. Then I saw another angel coming up from the rising of the sun, holding the seal of the living God. And with a loud voice, he called out to the four angels to whom it was granted to have power and an authority to harm the earth and the sea, saying, "Do not harm the earth, nor the sea, nor the trees, until we seal," mark, "the bondservants of our God on their foreheads." And I heard how many were sealed. 144,000, 12,000, there's that 12, sealed from every tribe of the sons of Israel. 12,000 were sealed from Judah, 12,000 were sealed from Reuben, 12,000 were sealed from Gad, 12,000 were sealed from Asher, 12,000 were sealed from the tribe of Naphtali, 12,000 from the tribe of Manasseh, 12,000 from the tribe of Simeon, 12,000 from the tribe of Levi, 12,000 from the tribe of Issachar, 12,000 from the tribe of Zebulun, 12,000 from the tribe of Joseph, and 12,000 from the tribe of Benjamin were sealed, marked, redeemed, and protected. A multitude from the tribulation, a multitude from the tribulation. After these things, I looked, and this is what I saw, a vast multitude which no one could count. Now, remember, we already had the 12 from the 12 tribes, the 12,000s, right? Now we're talking about the additional people in addition to those 12, 12 by 12, 144,000. After these things, I looked, and this is what I saw, a vast multitude which no one could count. So that means it's not just going to be 144,000. A vast multitude which no one could count, gathered from every nation and from all the tribes and peoples and languages of the earth, standing before the throne and before the Lamb of Christ, dressed in white robes with palm branches in their hands, and in a loud voice they cried out, saying, "Salvation belongs to our God who is seated on the throne, and to the Lamb. Our salvation is the Trinity's to give, and to God the Trinity we owe our deliverance." And all the angels were standing around the throne and around the 24 elders and the four living creatures. And they fell to their faces before the throne and worshiped God, saying, "Amen, blessing and glory and majesty and wisdom and thanksgiving and honor and power and might belong to our God forever and ever. Amen. Then one of the elders responded, saying to me, these are who are dressed in long white robes. Who are they, and from where did they come? And I said to him, my Lord, you know the answer. And he said to me, here it is, people. These are the people who come out of the great tribulation. So remember how I said in past episodes that there will be some people, some Christians, some followers of Christ, who will experience some tribulation. What is tribulation? Persecution. Some of us right now are experiencing persecution. The martyrs, the people who would be martyrs, obviously have experienced some persecution, right? But the number of these folks could not be numbered. There were so many, the scripture just said. They will be given these long white robes, and they're dressed before the Lord. These are the people who come out of the great tribulation, and they have washed their robes and made them white in the blood of the Lamb because of his atoning sacrifice. For this reason, they are standing before the throne of God, and they serve him in worship day and night in his temple. And he who sits on the throne will spread his tabernacle over them and shelter and protect them with his presence. They will no longer hunger nor thirst anymore, nor will the sun beat down on them, nor any scorching heat. For the Lamb who is in the center of the throne will be their shepherd, and he will guide them to the springs of waters of life. And God will wipe away every tear from their eyes, giving them eternal, everlasting comfort. So, from now till next week, I pray that you have an opportunity to reread these passages and allow the Holy Spirit to impart to you the vision as he has given it to John, so that we can continue to understand what it is that the Lord is about to do in our lives. I believe, as I said before, that we are nearing the time when the bridegroom will return to receive his bride. And it is our job to be ready, to preach the word, to teach the word in season and out of season, to rightly divide the scriptures as the power of the Holy Spirit has given us. I pray that you have an opportunity to study this word, and we will visit again on next week, if the Lord's will, for our live broadcast of Basically It's Biblical at 3 p.m. Eastern Standard Time, and with our Friday night preview. I will present that as well on next week. I hope to have soon the application or the app that I spoke to you about, so that it may make it easier for you to access the podcast. And I'm still working on that. And until then, may the Lord add a blessing to the reader.